From Iqaluit in Canada's north, the Nunavut Snow Challenge. Brought to you by Canadian North. Global Star. Atlas Van Lines.
Hi, I'm George Athens. Welcome to Iqaluit in Canada's newest territory of Nunavut, where it is an absolutely beautiful day, but minus 45 degrees Celsius with the wind chill factor. We're here for the third annual Nunavut Snow Challenge. It's a 328-kilometer snowmobile race over some of the most beautiful, barren, and treacherous landscape on Earth. Working with me on this unique sporting challenge is TV personality Misty Lowry.
Thanks very much, George. Today, close to 50 racers will compete in one of the most grueling sporting events in the world. These racers will hit speeds of up to 130 kilometers and be exposed to wind chills that can drop to minus 60 degrees Celsius. I'll say it, George, and I'm sure you're going to agree, it's the ultimate test of man and machine.
Well, it sounds cool to me, so let's get right to the action.
We're now looking down at the start-finish area for the race. This is Frobisher Bay, just below the city of Iqaluit. Sea ice covers the bay for all but 3 months of the year. The summer is the only time that ships can get into this harbor to deliver goods. For the rest of the year, this part of Canada is only accessible by commercial aircraft. Canadian North flies regular flights to Iqaluit. Of interest, this runway is also an alternative for the U.S. space shuttle in the case of emergency landings.
But it's all about fast takeoffs this morning, George, and the competitors are getting set for the race right now. They have come from all over Nunavut and northern Quebec for this Arctic adventure.
With the extreme wind chill, these riders will be exposed to temperatures that can freeze gasoline. But in all my conversations with the competitors, the cold does not seem to be an issue. Of course, they know how to dress properly for this kind of climate, and some even cover their faces with aluminum duct tape to prevent frostbite.
Side by side, you have to stay in that formation until you get past the start-finish line. It's going to be clear.
Tom Brigard is the race director for the Nunavut Snow Challenge, and he says the racers will face some blowing snow along the course today.
We're a little bit concerned that they'll be running across a trail that they can't really see, and if they can't see where they're going, there's the possibility of hitting rocks that are just covered over by drifts, and that's always really dangerous.
Race day attracts a lot of local residents to the Nunavut Snow Challenge. It's one of the big events up here on the social calendar, and it's a real family outing.
Riders must refuel during this race, so much earlier today, crew members had to head out with gas to the pit stop areas. Riders are now heading to the starting grid. The grid was determined a few minutes ago. Here is a look at the first four rows of the grid. It's not based on any pre-qualifying times, just a random draw. So this is by no means an indication of how the riders will finish in the race. Jimmy Gordon Jr. is the defending champion. He won last year's race in a course record time of 3 hours and 2 minutes.
Well, it looks like we're just about set to go here as we see the Premier of Nunavut, Paul Ukulik, offering his best wishes to the two pole sitters in today's race. The Premier was just re-elected for a second term, so I'm sure that he knows a little something about winning races, too.
The focus for us here is that we want to get our culture and our language strengthened, at the same time promote our territory, and this race helps in that we got to get our economy going, and the more wonderful activities that we have for our territory, the more job creation that it creates for us. So that's what I'm looking forward to on this term.
These competitors spend more time on snowmobiles than they do in automobiles, so all of them are race ready. This outdoor adventure covers a lot of territory, so the only way to cover the race properly is with a special helicopter mounted camera called a Westcam.
The Westcam is a gyro-stabilized camera platform. Basically, its purpose is to take the bumps and jitters out from what you would normally have in a helicopter, so you have a nice smooth image.
Back to the sea ice now. It's a rolling start. Pace Machine is now taking the riders past the Premier and the checkered flag, but the competitors will remain in formation and under caution until they see a green flag. Then it's full speed ahead. Here we go. It's a clean start. Look at those machines accelerate so fast that our helicopter can barely keep up with them. The racers on the front row of the grid quickly jockeying for position. Number 50, Dave Sudlowapik, has the lead. At least the early lead. He was born here in Iqaluit. He has been riding snowmobiles for 10 years, but this is one of his first races. Number 18, Norman Mike, is another local favorite. He is going flat out. Mike passing this machine like it was standing still. Mike placed third in last year's race. Sudlowapik out front, but he has close company here in the early stages of the race. They are breathing down his neck.
Always a ton of pressure on a leader. You lead, follow, or you get out of the way.
This is number 13, David Kelly from Iqaluit. He hopes to put himself on the map today.
There we go. The start line is at 64 degrees north of the equator in the community of Iqaluit. The halfway and turnaround point is to the south in Kimmaroo. Kimmaroo has a population of 400 people, and it looks like some of them are already outdoors waiting to see the racers pass by. There are also two other checkpoints along the course and a few refueling areas.
Our leader, Dave Sudlowapik, has now reached the pack ice. This is about 10K away from the start line. There is only a small path through this very rough part of the course, so the racers have to slow down. Passing is almost impossible. More racing to come. We'll return to Canada's North and the Nunavut Snow Challenge in a moment.
There was some concern earlier on today that the race might have to be postponed. It was delayed for several hours while a rescue helicopter tried to find a group of competitors who got lost yesterday in a blizzard.
Around 3:30 in the afternoon, the storm hit us, and so we had to park there, and we stayed there about 12 hours under the tarp.
Luckily, all five persons were found late this morning. The rescue included a young boy who was flown back to civilization with the help of our very own race promoter, James Patterson.
Racers are now arriving at the first checkpoint. Number 17, Bobby Gordon, there now. This is 52K into the race, and the weather has changed dramatically up here. Gordon is in sixth position at the moment. As we climb into the mountain area of the course, there is a lot of low-level blowing snow. Norman Mike in the thick of it. Bad news ahead for our leader, Dave Sudlowapik. The signal says it all. Dave is out of the race with a mechanical problem. He'll need a Global Star satellite phone to make a call for towing. Back to number 17, Bobby Gordon from Tujuaq, Quebec. He has moved up to fifth place. Certainly within striking distance, Bobby is one of five related Gordons entered in this race. Ahead of Gordon in third place, number six, Kevin Sudlovnik. He is from Iqaluit, where he works for the RCMP. Kevin is trailing David Kelly, who is riding in second place. No holding back for David. He pushes his machine to the limit. Kelly is a whale hunter by profession, so he is used to a good challenge every now and then. Kevin Sudlovnik pulling up to make a pit stop here at the bottom of Mount Joy. He has some kind of a problem, though, with his ski, steering, or suspension. He'll have to fix it fast if he hopes to stay among the top three. Mount Joy, one of the refueling locations along the course. Well, Norman Mike has been playing it perfectly so far. He is one of the big guns from Team Nunavut. Kevin Sudlovnik giving us the signal there. Looks like he's got his mechanical problem solved. Back on course, making up for lost time. Lots of beautiful scenery up here. It's been a real trip for our crew. David Kelly, our leader, as he appears to be slowing down. Kelly now has some kind of a problem. From here, it looks like a broken belt. He should be able to fix that on the fly. Yes, he looks over his shoulder, and he's off and running again with no other riders in sight, just plenty of great scenery.
April 1st, 1999, Nunavut became Canada's newest and largest territory. In Inuktitut, the language of the Inuit, Nunavut means our land, and it covers nearly 2 million square kilometers of land and water. This part of Canada's north has been home to the Inuit and earlier Arctic inhabitants for thousands of years. They survived by hunting, fishing, and trading. It was a remote and harsh existence. The Hudson's Bay Company set up shop in Canada's north in the 1600s, and that later included a post here in Iqaluit. The bay provided a reliable supply of goods to hunters in exchange for furs and sealskins. The language, history, and traditions of the Inuit have been passed down from generation to generation in song, dance, and especially in hand-carved sculptures from the artists of this region. The very best work is displayed and sold in galleries around the world. This amazing piece of sculpture is housed in the legislative building in the capital of Iqaluit. It tells the age-old story of hunting in the Arctic. Today, many Inuit still hunt and fish like their forefathers did, but now it's in their own territory. In May of 1993, the Inuit signed the world's largest native land claim agreement. This took more than 10 years to negotiate with the federal government. Iqaluit is the capital of Nunavut, and it's home to about 6,000 residents.
This is Nunavut's new legislative building in the capital of Iqaluit. There are approximately 27,000 people living in Nunavut's 25 communities. There are 19 elected MLAs, and collectively they elect a premier. And he, like the rest of the elected officials, sit in seats like these, lined in sealskin.
The best way to get around Iqaluit is in an all-terrain vehicle, big trucks, and of course, snowmobiles. Only a few of the roads are marked with signs, though, and there is no road out of the city. The closest you can get to that is right here, and it's called the Road to Nowhere. Other oddities include a husky in almost every driveway. St. Jude's Cathedral, which is constructed like an igloo. And homes that are built on steel pylons, which are drilled into rock. It's way too cold to run water pipes in the ground here. They would freeze and break. So a water tanker has to come and fill most of the houses in town almost on a daily basis. Despite this inconvenience and the constant cold, the local residents have a great sense of humor.
The remoteness and natural beauty of Nunavut are two of its biggest attractions, but this comes at a price. Almost everything has to be airlifted into this region, which makes for a very high cost of living. For example, this container of orange juice here costs nearly $12, and these bananas are $1.89 a pound. Wow.
The Arctic char beats those bananas, Misty, as we return to the action and our leader, David Kelly, as he approaches Kimmeridge and the halfway mark of the race. This is about 160K from the start line. Kelly has a good lead on the competition. And it does not appear as he is going to have to refuel here. He must be keeping a good eye on that since last year he ran out of gas during the race. Just a checkpoint. And Kelly is firing up back on his machine and blasts off for the return trip to Iqaluit. Kelly has a pretty good lead on number 6, Kevin Sablovnik, and number 17, Bobby Gordon, who are running a close second and third here at Kimmeridge. Close behind them is number 18, Norman Mike. It'll be a fast fill-up for some. And then it's back to the race and a repeat journey to the finish line. More racing ahead as we return to Iqaluit for the Nunavut Snow Challenge.
Raven Rock, CKIQ, AM/FM, it's 439 Drive 25. Glenn with you until 6 tonight. Don't forget 70s 8-track flashback coming your way. And I know you're not going to forget about this weekend. We've got the Nunavut Snow Challenge where you can experience the exhilaration of the great run from Iqaluit to Kimmaroot. We want to welcome all those who are here for the event. A lot of celebrities coming to town. And hey, speaking of celebrities, hell, we got a show lined up for you. Northern Pikes at the FOL Hangar Friday night.
That concert took place last night. The Northern Pikes, the perfect house band for this part of Canada. Interesting venue for some rock and roll. The concert was staged in a Canadian military hangar similar to those used in the early 1960s for the U.S. Strategic Air Command Unit.
Back to the fast lane again. This is what the drivers see from their vantage point while out on the race course. Lots of flying snow if they are in the wake of another driver and machine. Below us is Ted Ernick. He is now running in approximately 10th place. He's from Yellowknife and has been riding for 16 years. Bobby Gordon, he is racing a machine. His girlfriend won in a local bingo game. What a prize. Kelly now heading up Mount Joy in what has to be a last refueling area for most competitors. No stopping here for our leader, though. He is good to go. He must have enough gas for his charge to the finish line. Norman Mike holding on to second place. But he'll probably need some fuel to take him home. Mike first got on a snowmobile as a child to go hunting with his father.
Ice hockey is another popular winter sport here in Nunavut. Children can play hockey almost anywhere with no problem of finding some ice. It must have been the same way for Jordan Tutu.
Now there's one youngster who certainly has drawn a great deal of attention.
1-0 lead.
Off it comes for Tutu, a shot, knee, rebound, and score!
Tutu is the first Inuit to ever play in the NHL, and he is a very important role model in this region.
He flips it in as it comes down to Jordan Tutu. Tutu working right side with Johnson, and he pulled his shot wide.
Another great inspiration for the people of Nunavut has been the Cannes Film Festival award-winning movie called The Fast Runner. Its director, Zacharias Canuck, is from Nunavut, and the film was shot here. Critics have hailed this movie as a modern-day epic masterpiece, a film where almost each shot radiates the divinity of life.
It's a modern-day Nanook of the North. Back to the race, David Kelly in the driver's seat with the finish line close ahead. We'll return for the flying conclusion of the Nunavut Snow Challenge after this break.
Snowmobiles may be the most modern and preferred mode of transportation here in Nunavut, but hey, for a more traditional way of getting around, there's always dog sleds. It's early Thursday morning, and before going to work as a lawyer in Iqaluit, former Montrealer Paul Crowley is out running his dog sled team. It's a northern version of a walk in the park, just a tad bit colder.
The dogs they're teaming themselves. They're kind of like a pack. They have a boss, they have a leader, they have a scapegoat often. It's kind of like office politics in a small little group, but they definitely work as a team.
Crowley takes these morning outings with his dog sleds whatever he can, but on occasion he has to give the dog sled to his wife, who uses it to go on multi-day business trips to other communities in Nunavut.
Cut, 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 cut.
We're now in the home stretch. 21-year-old David Kelly well ahead of his closest competition with a finish line in sight. Kelly has survived a bent steering rod and an unscheduled stop to change a belt. Here he is. He crosses the finish line, a time of 3 hours, 16 minutes, 22 seconds in his Polaris XE700. Number 13, a lucky number for Kelly today.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Great ride.
Yes.
Was it tough today?
Yes, blizzard halfway.
Yeah?
Yeah, can't see anything.
How far are you ahead of the others, do you think?
I don't know. I have no clue.
Norman Mike will finish second, about 2 minutes behind the winner.
Congratulations. What was the toughest part of the course for you?
When the snow was blowing, like, I couldn't see far. Only 5 feet of it.
This is now Junior May, who had a remarkable drive from the back of the pack to finish third.
My muffler came off right at the beginning of the race, so I had to stop, so I was last right from the beginning. So I passed about maybe 20, 30 people.
So you picked up a lot of ground.
Yeah.
How do you feel, actually? You tired? You look pretty good.
Good that I'm alive.
Now a look at the final results. Kelly is the winner, but Junior May was the comeback kid. Defending champion Jimmy Gordon finishes fifth. It was again a battle between racers from Nunavut and Quebec, but the hometown favorite prevailed. Moshe Cote, the sales manager for Canadian North, awards David Kelly with the winner's trophy. Kelly will also get a check for $10,000.
Well, that concludes our coverage of the Nunavut Snow Challenge, the only race of its kind anywhere in the world. Misty, it's been quite an outdoor adventure here in Canada's North.
I'd say, George, we've covered a ton of ground here in Nunavut, Canada's newest and largest territory, and I hope that you enjoyed the show.
So, on behalf of Misty Lowry, I'm George Athens. Bye-bye from Iqaluit.
From Iqaluit in Canada's North, the Nunavut Snow Challenge. Brought to you by Canadian North. Global Star. Atlas Van Lines.
You and I are worlds away. There's nothing we can do or say to change the way that all things are, except you wonder.